Nigeria began easing restrictions on Monday in its capital, Abuja, and the commercial city, Lagos, marking the reopening of Africa's biggest economy after more than 4 weeks of lockdown. Nigeria has recorded 2,558 confirmed cases of the new coronavirus and 87 deaths since recording its first case at the end of February, a much lower toll than those seen in COVID-19 hotspots in Europe and the United States. The government has set a stay-at-home order in place since March 13 in Abuja, and the states of Lagos and Ogun will be lifted gradually over a six-week period. The regions will now come in line with the rest of the country, where the restrictions in force were less strict and include an overnight curfew, mandatory face mask in public, and a ban on non-essential interstate travel.
It's not really a good thing carrying two passengers because we are not going to make up to the money we are making before. So it's not impressive at all.
There is no increase in salary and there are increase in prices. In fact, companies are not paying full salaries. So this has an adverse effect on my budget as a person.
I'm not happy. We are not happy. I don't have money in my pocket. I have family. I'm a father of three. There's nothing at home right now. I was coming to work telling my wife to pray for me to work and bring something so that we eat. But as you can see, there's no hope of working today.
Market no day, no life for you. But we still pray for God.
Nothing is moving. We did not sell anything today.
As you can see now, we cannot take more than, like this one used to take 40 passengers before. We have to reduce this to 10 passengers.
The initial amounts they are. When we enter transport for 15 naira, we pay like 150 naira now.
Please, we are facing problem for here now. As a businessman, some of us now can collect loan from bank. And now, we did 1 month now, we never work. You understand? How are you going to pay the bank, please?
And 2 weeks, they don't lock us now. And no government don't give us anything. I don't move the succeed. I don't move the shop.
And with a few hours before the 8 p.m. curfew begins, it's a mad rush for people to get home before 8 p.m. The general feeling here is that of apprehension and despondency. From the Sakatinibu market in Victoria Island, Lagos, Nigeria, Mary Chinda reporting for Plus TV Africa.
With us in the studio now is Plus TV Africa correspondent Mary Chinda. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you.
You look tired. You've had a long day, I presume.
Yeah.
All right. We'll also be joined by our Abuja correspondent as well, Amadine Uyi. He joins us via Skype. Thank you very much, Amadine, for your time.
Thank you, Felicity.
All right. I know it's also been a long one for you as well. Let's start with you, Mary. What's the general impression with the relaxation of lockdown on the streets of Lagos? I know you were at various locations.
So this is today's Monday 4th, and it's like letting a goat that you've tied for a long time loose. And people are scared. But they want to make the most of today. In other words, people want to trade. Traders in the market want to trade to be able to earn a living, to take something home. It's like today's day one, and they want to make make up for all of the money that they've lost in the last 5 weeks. So it's just like letting a goat that you've caged, you know, loose.
Amadine, is that the same reality in Abuja, or is different?
Now, the situation in Abuja, in the capital, was such that most of the traders we met, especially around the Mpape area of Abuja, they were excited and they committed to the federal government. Is it the lockdown? So, but what... many of them commended the federal government for easing the lockdown. They were extremely unhappy at the palliative distribution. They said that they were not happy that the federal government did not fulfill its promises to many of them during the 5 week lockdown in the federal capital. But a lot of them expressed optimism that now that the lockdown had been eased in the federal capital, they were hoping that they would pick up their lives once again.
All right. There was some interference while you were talking. I was trying to interject to get your attention, but we're able to get most of what you were saying. Let me come back to Mary. I'll be with you in a bit. What's your observation when it comes to social distancing and, you know, compliance with other use of face mask and, you know, availability of, you know, sanitizing, washing your hands and all of that? What did you notice today?
Social distancing today is, I would score it a 30 of 100. If you look at, I'm churning out the report for 8 p.m. at GT Bank, where we went to, and I took clips. People were packed like sardines. They were trying to make their way to the banking hall to, you know, maybe deposit or withdraw their monies, whatever it was. But there was little compliance. And it wasn't just that GT Bank alone. Several banks, you know, especially GT banks all across Lagos, had people turning out, you know, rushing to get into the bank.
So there was no social distancing.
And you would wonder, all of these 5 weeks you've been at home, didn't you hear or understand that you are supposed to keep, you know, some meters away from the next person? But people feel that, okay, because I'm wearing nose masks, I'm fine. No, so for social distancing, I would say it was a 30 over 100 compliance.
So more enlightenment is required.
For the nose masks, almost everybody that I saw today, almost all the people that I interviewed had their nose marks as though it were a uniform or a badge. Then for the Sakatinibu market where I was reporting from, there were sanitizers, there were hand washing bowls and water for people to get to, you know, wash their hands and all of that. So yes, for the nose marks, because people know, I feel that people are even complying to the nose marks thing because they know that they are going to be arrested if they don't do it, you know. But then people should also understand that yes, wearing a nose mask does not mean that you are going to violate the guideline of social distancing. It's something, it's commonsensical, and I think it's something that we should, you know, brace Look ourselves at. Up to.
Amadine, I want to take it to another angle to what's in Abuja. Passengers, buses, tricycle, keke napep, as we know it. What's the level of compliance? We know that buses are not supposed to carry more than 4 passengers. The keke napep, which is the local language for tricycle, is not supposed to carry more than 2 passengers. What was your observation today on the streets of Abuja?
Now, we should talk about the capital city, which has the executive offices of the ministries, departments, and agencies. There is a level of compliance because the check-in is very strict. Even getting access into the federal capital, you meet a lot of checkpoints. So the problem there is there's not much problem enforcing people to comply. But the problem is the satellite communities. You talk a lot about the satellite communities of Mpape, Lugbe, Mararaba, Nyanya, Karo, even down to Kurudo and the Karishi area. There is absolutely no form of compliance when you talk of social distancing. The tricycle operators are still carrying their normal 4 passengers. The commercial motorcycle operators are still carrying their passengers as normal. But if you go out of the satellite communities into the city center, there is a level of compliance. Felicity.
Okay, Amadine. What was your experience in Lagos? Is it similar to what he said?
There is a general hike in the transport fares today, Felicity. It's so heartbreaking. Coming to work alone from Aja to VR, it was normally what would cost me 100 naira was now costing me 200 naira. But some people, they had to pay 400 naira instead of 200 naira. So the cost of transportation has doubled. Yeah, and well,
Was that reflected in the social distancing in the buses?
The social distancing for buses today, I would say that the compliance was just about 50%. Now, most buses both the buses I used and the ones that I interviewed, would, instead of having 14 passengers, they would say, okay, we're now carrying 10. But in the 10, you have 4 people. behind. You have one person at the driver's seat. You have four people again, and then you have four. You have three or four people, and you're saying that you are maintaining social distances. What kind of social distancing are you maintaining?
Did you observe any officers? Did you observe any security officers along the route?
No, at the VI area and the Ajah area where I monitored, there were no security operatives looking for ensuring that these bus drivers maintain the social distancing thing. And can I tell you something that I observed today? One of the bus drivers said to me, I don't let anybody who doesn't have a nose mask into the bus. And even when you have a nose mask, I give you a hand sanitizer if you don't have. And I said to him, let me see your hand sanitizer. And he brought dry gin, Felicity. Dry gin. And he said to me, dry gin is better than using hand sanitizers. And I say to him, this is not hand sanitizer. And he's giving it to passengers. Passengers are using dry gin, and it's okay because it's alcohol. And there's no one checking it, maybe because they feel that, okay, they're going to sort the policemen. And this is where corruption comes in.
What worries you about this, Amadine, what Mary has just said, and based on your observation of what is happening in Abuja, what worries you about this lack of compliance with the guidelines?
The fear is that the coronavirus will get to the community spread level. The fear has been there, and there's this fear that once it happens, it will start from the satellite communities. Remember, like I said some time ago here on air, if you understand the structure and the nature of Abuja, you have a federal capital city, which is the city center, which houses the offices of the ministries, departments, and agencies, the three armed zone, the National Assembly. Most of the time, government's emphasis are on these areas within the city center. But if you, even before the lockdown was eased, if you had gone to the satellite communities, I mentioned a few the last time I spoke, you will find out that there was no level of compliance to the president's directive on a lockdown. Now that the lockdown had been lifted, what the police were doing, you have to give kudos to the personnel of the Nigerian Police Force. Yes, they set up checkpoints at different areas, but citizens still, you could see most of the time that it was like they were overwhelmed by citizens. Now that the lockdown has been eased, what we had expected in the federal capital is that the security operatives will ensure, number one, social distancing, number two, compliance.
Hello, Amadine. Okay, I'm afraid we lost Amadine there, but he was making some submission, vital submission. So in summary, from what you've observed, is this relaxation a good call, or should government give serious consideration to rescinding that decision and taking us back to that period of lockdown to help manage the social distancing situation?
Well, I wouldn't say rescinding the decision, because once they, you know, we had issues within security because the economy was locked down, and then people do not even have enough to eat, and an angry person is actually a violent person. So we don't want to go back to that. But what we are saying is maybe the Lagos State government should think about reducing the number of persons that are allowed out. Yes, we know that they are, for the markets and the stores, they are actually are going to be open on alternate days, just like the governor said last week. But I think that the governor should think about reducing the number of persons that are allowed in. And we know that the issue that we're going to face with this gradual phasing out of the lockdown is the issue of inflation. How can people come out of their houses and instead of paying 200 naira, they are now paying 400 when there is no money already being made? Monies have been lost in the last 5 weeks. So we should think about, okay, maybe we need to, you know, think about still giving out this palliative, still, you know, trying to put in some money to cushion the effects that this is going to have on the normal Nigerian.
Thank you very much, Mary, for joining us on the news.
Thank you.
And of course, we thank Amadine Oyi, who joined us from Abuja. Thank you very much, Amadine.
Thank you, Felicity.